that in the Lord, and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye upright. Holiness. paying me a temple, not because of us, but because of you. Today we ask you to allow us to know you because we need to. Yes, so much time we forget that we know you, but we aren't. There's so many things that happen when we doubt you. We deny you. But there's someone to ask if we know you, or if I will be yes. So today, O Father, I'm asking for anything big from you. I will ask now with a heart like yours. And just help us to be like Jesus. We read your words, we listen to your words, but sometimes it doesn't make a change in our life. Today, O Father, we recognize that we need change, we need you more than ever. So we're asking from you to give up a heart like yours. We're asking you to keep us out of love, not out of panic. These are the main ingredients in our life that we are lacking. But today we pray to you again, O God, you have mercy. And to allow us to recognize that just enough our coming to church is not Christianity. We need to surrender our heart. And dear Father, there's so much things that could have happened to us for this since this COVID, but you steered us. And I believe you steered us for a reason. You have been long suffering for with us for many, many years. So we pray, oh God, that today will be the day of cleansing. Today will be the day that we will move away from the things that we not like you. Today will be the day for our full surrender. So I present every person who is bowing before that this time. I know, Father, you know your heart. You know our desires. And I pray, Father, you will grant us our wishes. I just want to lift up what we tell before you in a very special way. And there's some wonderful, very special in this house. And it is the name of Brother Roddy. Father, I want to lift him up before you right now. And if yesterday I saw him and you were to who be the church today. But Father, I want to lift him up before you right now. Allow your Holy Spirit to touch him. That as from now, he will never be ready. He will be a child of the King. I present him. Whatever is hindering him from giving all to you, I place it before the cross right now. And ask the Father for us healing. Whatever struggles he is struggling with, we know that you is God enough. That you can remove. Remove whatever. Now I want to place the one who will give us your word today. Many of us know him as Jehovah. But today I want you to give in a very special way. I want your message you give to speak to us. It will be the message of the day, and it will be the message of our heart. Thank you, Lord, for your offering to us.
Thank you. have been privileged one more time to be gathered in the house of the Lord. And if you know what it likes to be up here to look around you down there, God has been good to us, and He has provided many ways. We have the virtual ways of communicating and worship online. But nothing compares when we get up to the house of the Lord and sit and look at each other and hear the delivered word. And I say praise be to God. One more time, we are privileged to listen to a message from God's manservant. The person who has been selected to do so is one of our elders. Somebody very deep in the research, very thorough. And today I believe through his natural ability and the Holy Spirit's leading, he has a message to be delivered to all of us today. But I pray for him not just for our undivided attention, but I pray for him all part that he will allow the Holy Spirit to use in the way it needs to be used, and that the message that will be delivered will be one that will bring transformation to each of our lives. I speak of Lord Honor and Elder Philip Brooks. Before he comes to speak to us, however, Sister Kilburn, the birthday girl, will give us a birthday song of meditation, after which Elder Brooks will speak to us.
God brought me through my trial. He will do the same. in the house of the Lord?
Oh, yes.
Let me hear you. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Wonderful, wonderful. Let me thank Sister Kilburn and say happy birthday to her. And those persons who take part in the service today. Let me welcome all our visitors to church today. Members, we're happy to have you. It's good to see you worshiping the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let me salute my Gretchen Roddy. Good to see you. Alright? Yes, man. The Lord is so good to us. And we can praise Him for His mercy and all of His goodness. Alright, let me welcome you too. It's the first time we've been up here since the pandemic. So we're going back to what we usually do. Just three of us this time. Hopefully we'll get back to the usual normal that we were before. But nonetheless, we're in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Alright. So since we're just getting back to normal, we'll just talk a little bit today. And I just want to let you know, friend, that God loves you.
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
Amen.
He certainly does. Alright, grab the Bibles then. Let's read something and so we can move on. Turn your Bibles with me then to Luke chapter 18. And we'll read a little bit of this parable. I just need about probably 7 verses to start us off. Are you there? Luke chapter 18. 1-7. You want to read with me, that's fine. Well, again, and he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought to sometimes pray, don't you?
Always.
And not
always
to pray and not to faint, saying, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubled me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. Finally, and shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? Oh, yeah. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful to you for your love and your mercy. We come in your presence once more because we know that you are here with us. So today we want to lift up your name and give you all the glory. We pray, Lord Heavenly Father, that you will touch this cup, this filter wrap. However, I speak today will be off you and me. You get the praise, the honor, and the glory. Give it your making congregation. May you touch somebody's life today. And in the end, we all receive a blessing, we pray. In Jesus' name. Today I speak to you a bit about the apple of his eye. The apple of his eye. So the woman we just read about moments ago, the widow, who entreated the judge for justice. And you know, if she becomes a widow, she would have what? Lost her husband by death, don't it? Poor, friendless, she had no means of retrieving her ruined fortunes. And you and I today, by sin, we have lost our connection with God, don't it?
Yes.
And of ourselves, we have no means
salvation. I'm going to tell you something, friends. In Christ, we are what? Brought nigh unto the Father, don't it? The elect of God are dear to his heart. And I just said to you, mentioned it to you a while ago, that God loves you. Yeah. I want you to know that. Yeah. We are dear to his heart. Yeah. He has called us, friends, out of darkness into his marvelous light. And for us to show forth his praise, to shine as light amid the darkness of this world. So the unjust judge, he had no special interest in the widow who pressed him for deliverance. But yet, in order to rid himself of her pitiful plea, or her pitiful appeal, he heard it. Yes, he heard her plea and delivered her from her adversary. But God loves us, friend, let me remind you. He loves his children with an infinite love. Because, friends, to God, the dearest object on earth is what? His people. To God, the dearest object on earth is his people. I want you to get back to the text that was read to you by Chantal in Deuteronomy
32.
Chapter 32. And listen to what the Bible says. If you don't believe it, but I am telling you that you are dear to God. Deuteronomy 32, 9 and 10, the Bible says, for the Lord's portion is what? His people.
Yes.
Jacob is the what? Lot of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste hollering wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. And what? I want you to read the last part.
He kept him as the apple of his
eye. I want you to get it lower than that. Huh? He kept him as an apple of his eye. Have you ever said that to anybody yet? Huh? You've never said that to anybody? Go on, I'll say it to you, Mary.
No, I'm not married.
Okay. Where's Marcia? You're an apple of my eye. Hey, you see, that is what God is saying, friends. Infinite love. He has for all of us. The apple. I want to prove more to you. Go with me then to Zechariah chapter 2 and verse 8. Let me give you a love verse today. The Bible says, for thus said the Lord of hosts, after the glory hath he sent me unto the nation which spoil you. For he that what? Toucheth you does what?
Toucheth
the apple of his eye. The Lord is very serious, virgin, when it comes out to his love. Yes. So, friend, the widow's prayer, avenge me, do me justice of my adversary, represents the prayer of all of us today. It's the prayer of all of God's children. And as you and I know, friend, that Satan is our what? Greatest adversary, don't you? He's the accuser of the brethren. Huh? And he accused them before God day and night. And you want me to prove it to you? Go to Revelation 12 and verse 10. Revelation 12 and verse 10, the Bible said, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come what? Salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is what? That stone which accused them before our God day and night. So see, Father, you don't want big business. As soon as you tell yourself that, oh, you're a little bit upright and you think you're a little bit godly, he's there to present your case before God and accuse of all the things that you have ever done. That's the job of the adversary. He is continually working to misrepresent and accuse, to deceive and to destroy the people of God. That is the job of Satan. And it is for deliverance, friend, from the power of Satan and his angels. And in this part, Christ teaches us to pray. Because Satan has oppressed the body. They call me like a thief. And they call me back all the time. Huh? You never got a bush yet, but that's some bush never try to tie up. You ever got a bush yet?
Yes.
You know, you don't got a bush yet. And you get tied up by some bush and you get so frustrated that you keep sometimes that you want, you know, you just want to let loose. And that is what Satan has suffered that kind of wool until you chose this foot or your skirt tail. Putting pressure on you. So in the prophecy, friends, of Zechariah, is God to view Satan's accusing work and the work of Christ in resisting the adversary of the people. Did you know that? You think say, it's because you're fighting Satan by he's not there,
no.
Or even there on a little bit beside you sometimes?
No.
Huh? It's because what? Huh? It's because of the resisting work of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Go with me. Again, the same passage, Zechariah, but we're going to chapter 3 this time. Chapter 3, Zechariah, 1 to 3. The Bible says, "And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan at his..." So you see where? You see Satan is right there, friends. Huh? Standing before the angel, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, "The Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem, rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire?" Now Joshua was clothed with what? Filthy garments, and stood before the angel. Friends, you and I today and the entire people of God are represented as criminal on trial. Joshua, as high priest here, is seeking for a blessing for his people who are in the affliction. And while he is pleading for you and I before God, Satan is right there, standing at his right hand as his adversary. And he's accusing the children of God and making their case appear as desperate as possible. So he presents, friends, he presents to God our evil doings. Huh? Did you know that? Our defects. Huh? He shows our faults and our failures and hoping that they will appear so bad in the eyes of God that he will render us no help whatsoever. Huh? Render us no help in our great need. But Joshua, as the representative of God's people, stand under condemnation. He's clothed, the Bible says, with filthy garments, aware of the sins of his people. And so he's weighed down with discouragement. Satan is pressing upon his heels, pressing upon his soul a sense of guiltlessness are sick and they are in difficulty, they ask you to pray for them. And when you get down on your knees, all you do is start to pray for them first. You're in trouble. You need to pray for yourself first.
Yes.
Or else you're in trouble. That prayer makes no sense. So what, you think say, you don't have any filthy rags? Because here is Joshua the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord.
And you would consider the high priest is well up here, don't you?
Don't you think so?
Oh, yes.
But Satan is there, weighing him down. And as Joshua, maybe they're standing, thinking about his past or whatever sin, he is what? Looking at his guiltless and his weight down with this fear. Weight down. Yet, friends, yet he stands there as a petitioner, and Satan is arrayed against him. The work of Satan, friends, as the accuser, began a long time ago in the video, know that?
Yes.
In heaven, not you.
Amen.
And did you know that this has been his work on earth ever since the fall of man? And did you know, let me remind you, that it will be his work in a special sense, not you?
Yes.
As we approach nearer to the close of earth history, not you?
Yes.
And as he sees his time is short, he will work with greater earnestness to begin that.
Yes.
To deceive and to destroy, because the truth is, friends, Satan is angry.
Yes.
When he sees a people on this earth who, even in their weakness and sinfulness, that we shall not obey God. He delights in all unworthiness. Satan is very angry, friend. Even in your weakness when you try to pray. Even at your worst state, no matter who you are, you could be a drunkard. I don't care who you want to be. Anytime Satan sees you go down on your knee, Satan is angry. You know that?
Yes.
He's angry. And sometimes the truth is, you and I would want to give over those persons. I'm not talking the truth.
Yes.
Sometimes friends want to give over some folks because you think they're not going to be able to make it. But the truth is, when those persons as bad and as sinful as we think they are, when they get down on their knees, Satan is furious.
Yeah.
Furious about the idea. Every time God works on our behalf, Satan and his angels work bigger to ruin us. I want to let you know that. He's jealous of all of us who made Christ our strength.
Yes.
His job is to instigate evil. And when he has succeeded, he truly blames God. You never know that.
Yes.
Huh? Whenever time Satan is successful in fooling you and I, turn around and show the blame on me. Because what? He points to our filthy garments, our defective character. He presents our weakness and our folly, our sins of ingratitude, our unlikeness to Christ. All these things he brings up against us as an argument, friends, proving that he has the right to destroy us and tell us that our case is hopeless. That is what Satan does. Tell everybody sometimes, Your case is hopeless. Huh? Just last night, Matthew was telling me of a man who jumped off the bridge in that way. They found him later on drunk. Now, did they say that was saying something good? Huh?
Yes.
It don't make no sense to continue living. It is worthless. So the best thing you can do right now is to jump off this bridge. That is the idea and the plan of Satan as it relates to God's children. Because the truth is, and that is the reason, friends, sometimes some persons can't go in this fear. Yes. But guess what, friends? We can appeal to the divine, Did you know that? Representative of God. The angel said, if thou wilt walk in my ways, and if thou wilt keep my charge, then shall also judge my house, and shall also keep my courts, and I will give thee places to walk among them that stand, but even among the angels that surround the throne of God. Friends, today is not how long I'm preaching. But if you're ever here today, and you haven't that yet, give your life to Jesus. I want to say that you pray that he's ready to give you a change of heart.
Amen. Amen.
No matter how bad, no matter how bad we are, no matter the situation that we are in, friends, Jesus will not walk away from us. The truth is, friends, he has the power to change our garments today.
Amen.
He removed the filthy garments. He places upon the repentant, believing ones his own robe of righteousness.
Amen.
And against your name today, friends, he will mark pardon. I hope it's your name. And on the record of heaven, he confesses them. He confesses them before his heavenly Father and before the entire universe. Satan, our adversary, is shown to be an accuser and a deceiver. God will do justice for his people. So today I know that maybe some persons may be feeling unworthy. Huh? Don't they? Yeah. Because when you look deep down in yourself, friends, you don't know the things that you've done in your life. And as I sometimes it will bring you down to despair, you feel a sense of hopelessness. But as I fear not, friends, to commit your case to God.
Amen.
Fear not. Because when he gave himself in Jesus for the sins of the world, he does what? Huh? He takes the case of every soul. You ever know that? When Jesus gave himself for the sins of this world, friends, did you know that? Huh? He takes the case of you and I, don't you? What he said when he died, he said, I will take up your case. I will be the lawyer for you. The final text for today is in Romans. Chapter 8:33. Romans chapter 8. Bible says, he that spared not his what? Own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things?
Amen.
That's what I'm saying, your friends. You know what, friends? You know what the problem is today? There is no danger that the Lord will neglect the prayers of his people. You know what the danger is? The danger is that in temptation and trial, they will become discouraged and fail to persevere in them. That's a real problem that we face now. Huh? Think about it. That is the danger, friends. It's not that the Lord will neglect our prayers, you know. It's that when we are through the temptation and all those things, we don't go to him after. That is the danger that we face. God, who dwells in the heavenly sanctuary, friends, he judges righteously. His pleasure. the Lord is saying to us. See the problems that we face with him now. Huh? That's what he's saying, you know. He wants to give you a new suit. He wants to give you a change of garment. And if you believe it today, friends, if you believe it today, that no matter how filthy your garment is, Jesus can make them white as snow. If you believe it, raise your hand. Huh? And if you believe, friends, that no matter how often or no matter how much you keep going to Jesus, he will do justice for you. Don't you say amen? Friends, if it is your desire today to have a change of raiment, to allow the Lord to come into your life, give you a change of garment, and as he said, if you will walk with him, he will do wonders for you. The Lord is waiting for us to come to him, to accept his change of garment for our lives. We have to plead the merits of our Lord and Savior. Amen. Jesus.